Thank you so much for the introduction, Grace. Good evening, good morning, depending on where you're at right now. Thank you so much for tuning in the first keynote speech at this year's Berkeley China Summit. My name is Darren. I'm also a content leader at BCS and an MBA at Berkeley Haas. Join us today is Asif Herji, who needs no introduction for those who follow fintech and cryptocurrency. It's our great honor to have him today, and we will love to hear what he has to share in regard with how he thinks blockchain technology as well as cryptocurrency will reinvent financial services. We highly encourage you to leave your questions in the chat box, and we'll try our best to answer those during our Q&A. All right, Mr. Asif Herji, the stage is yours.
Thanks, Darren. Appreciate you guys having me here. Welcome to everybody. Thank you for attending. I've been affiliated with Berkeley and Haas for a number of years. I was a professor at the school and taught a PE course, which I loved. And so it's my pleasure to genuine pleasure to be here. Now, let's talk about financial services and blockchain and what the impact will be. I want you to just understand the biases I come from. So first of all, I'm a software engineer by background. And I spent a lot of my time in fintech. So I helped build some of the world's first direct banks and direct insurers. And in dot-com one, I built what you would today call a robo-advisor. Besides being an operator, I've also been an investor with TPG and A16Z. I was a partner in both of those firms. I ran Ameritrade and Coinbase in a past life. So I come at this with some biases that hopefully you will understand as I walk through it. So let's start with an assertion. First assertion is that we're on the cusp of Internet 3 or Web 3, if you prefer. So we within financial services have seen two versions of the Internet so far. The first was when we went from mainframe to distributed computing. Then we had a decade of innovation and great companies being built like Google and Amazon, et cetera. And what that did for financial services is it really brought about the online everything era, like self-service. So we had online banks and online insurers and online brokers, et cetera. We basically took the application off the mainframe. We pushed it out to a web server on a PC, and we told the customer they could do things for themselves. And that's what led to the online era. Internet 2 came along, where basically we went from the web, the PC to a mobile phone like this, like everyone has. And it brought, again, a decade of innovation because of mobile cloud. We in financial services, we had things like mobile payments and QR code payments. And basically what happened is we took that application and we distributed it even further out, now to a small device that was handheld and could go anywhere the person wanted to go. But fundamentally, we didn't alter the nature of the transaction. What we did was we just, as I said, took the application and pushed further and further out, but the nature of the transaction didn't change. And certainly where the data was held didn't change. The data was still held centrally. And this is a big issue and a problem, because for example, if you ask Mark Andreessen what are some of the sins of the current internet, he will say that the two biggest mistakes that the designers, and he includes himself in that statement, of the modern internet made were, number one, they didn't take privacy seriously enough. And we'll come back to that for a moment. And privacy really being who controls the data and what data do they control. And secondly, they didn't implement payments within the internet. Yeah, we're all familiar with HTTP 404 errors, page not found. I'm sure all of us have hit that at some point or another. There's actually HTTP 405, payment not found. That's in the protocol. It's just never been implemented. And the reason it wasn't implemented is because they couldn't figure out how to do payments at scale, low value payments as well, in a cost effective way, and multi-currency. They couldn't figure it out, and so they never actually implemented it. And what that led to, that lack of control over data and the non-implementation of payment, it basically led to the internet that we have today. And the internet we have today is you get a service for free, like say Google or Facebook. It's supposedly free, right? I don't have to pay for it. However, that service collects a tremendous amount of data on me by my usage. And then it sells me as an advertising target to advertisers. And so really, if you or I are not paying for the service, we're not the customer, we're the product. And so that's really been the internet of today, where all of this data is being captured It's being mined by the networks that control it, and it's being sold. We are being sold as products, and this is a big problem. So what will be the internet of tomorrow? Internet 3 is fundamentally different. We're shifting from mobile cloud to what I would call decentralized web. And this is blockchain based at its core. And this is a much more fundamental change than any that we've been on before, because what we're doing this time is we're decentralizing the data and pushing the data out to the user, not the application, the data. And we're giving control of that data back to the user, which is a very powerful concept and very, very different to what we've done today. So it's a stupid example. If I was to leave Facebook today, I cannot take my friend graph with me, right? I can't take the table of my friends or all my photos. If I leave Twitter, I can't take all my tweets, even though those are mine, that's my IP. I can't take them with me. It's stuck on that platform. In the new world, in Web3, you'll be able to take all that with you because it'll be your data, not theirs. And this is a very profound change. This will impact everything. It'll be just as pervasive as the internet of today, except that with the user owning the data. And so it'll impact everything that you and I know and do, but especially financial services. Now, why do I say especially financial services? I'll get to that in a second. But first, let's start with, what is crypto or blockchain to begin with? Many of you will say it's an asset class. I invest in it or whatever. I'm sure a number of you own some crypto, hopefully with Coinbase. It isn't an asset class, right? To call it an asset class is really not to understand it. It is simply a way to build an application. That's it. It's a way to build an application. And if you view it that way, it will be the way applications of the future are built. And that one of the main differences is this time, the network effects and the economics of that application are built in from the start, right? Today, whenever we talk about a new application, we always say, hopefully it has network effects. The more people use it, the more people get stickier to it, et cetera, the more valuable it becomes. Yes, that's all true. In the future, with blockchain, the network and the economics are built in from the start. Now, there's two use cases I'm sure all of us are familiar with. There's Bitcoin, which is basically store of value or digital gold. There's Ethereum, which is a development platform for other crypto applications, kind of like the .NET or Java, if you're a technologist of blockchain apps. But I want to generalize this a bit. Let's say we were to build a true Web3 app that was something like we all use, say Uber. Okay, the Uber of today, going back to the sins that the internet creates, the Uber of today collects a tremendous amount of information on me. It knows where I live. It knows where I work. It knows my favorite restaurants. It knows where my gym is. It knows all this from my commute patterns and my usage patterns. It knows how often I go to the airport, et cetera. It could probably even tell if I was having an affair based on the map that it puts together of me. And all of that data, it owns. I don't own it. Even though it's my data, it owns. So let's say a bunch of us got together and said, we're going to create a new version of Uber. We're going to create a version of Uber on blockchain. So we would write the code. And one of the first things we'd have to do building it on blockchain is we'd have to define how many tokens it's going to have. This is a finite number that you set. It could be any number you want, but it's a finite number you set. Let's just say we created 100 billion tokens. Okay. The way you should think about the tokens is the sum total of the tokens should equal the NPV of the network revenues at scale. Okay. So whatever you think the network revenues will be, divide it by the number of tokens, that's what the token should be worth. Clearly, in the beginning, the token therefore is not worth very much because there are very few drivers, there's very few riders on the network when it first starts. Therefore, the network value is pretty low, therefore the token value will be pretty low. Now, it costs roughly $20 for me to go from my house to the central business district. That trip on the first time I use this new version of Uber might be 200,000 tokens because the tokens aren't worth very much. But as more drivers are starting on the service and more riders are starting on the service. And by the way, you can incent the drivers to start on the service by giving them tokens as a means of economic incentive to drive. So you give the drivers some tokens, you sell the tokens to the riders. As more and more drivers and riders come on, the network is more valuable, the token accretes in value. And that $20 trip that used to be 200,000 tokens, maybe now that's only 200,000. Maybe that's only 200 tokens, or maybe it's a 2/10 of a token, depending on how much the token is inflated. So that is the way that network accretes value, and it's the way the token reflects the accretion of value, and it's also the way that the participants in the network benefit from that value. if I was a driver that started on Uber early in this new model, and I was given a bunch of tokens as an incentive to drive, those tokens are now worth millions of dollars because the network has gone up in value and I benefited from that. Not only did I benefit from the network effects as the driver, but I, as a user, have all my data protected. Uber, all this new version of Uber knows is a wallet that has sufficient funds, wants to go from point A to point B, and that's it. It doesn't know who I am. It can't map that to some other transaction of mine. That's all it knows. And it doesn't capture any of that data. So in this new way of building an application, the economics and the governance as in decision-making over that network are built right in from the start. And, as I said before, the implications are pretty profound. The early adopters get to get upside in the network. Today, when you build a traditional app, the value of the network accretes only to the creators. In the future, when you build a Web3 app, the value of the network accretes to the early adopters. And then in terms of governance, if you wanted to, let's say you wanted to decide that there were different types of vehicles allowed or different types of rides allowed, that would be put out to a community vote. And anyone who had a token could vote. And if the majority vote for the change, then the change happens. Again, very different way of governing a network than we've had before. So if you pull this string along, what this tells you is there will be millions and millions of tokens because there will be millions and millions of applications. And each application will have a token that has that associated token, sorry, that is both the means of exchange on that network as well as the means of governance on that network. Not only will there be millions and millions of applications and therefore millions and millions of tokens, there'll be multiple millions because of the NFTs that are coming as well. These are fungible tokens, these are non-fungible tokens, things like prizes in games or skins or virtual art or you name it. Okay. Now we could do an entire piece just on NFTs. That's not what this is about. So I'm going to leave. That's the last thing I'm going to say about NFTs. I'm going to come back to tell me what this means for financial applications and services. I get that blockchain is a way to build an application, but why will it fundamentally recreate financial services for the better? Okay. So let's start there. The three fundamental traits that blockchain gives when it comes to financial services, besides those network effects and the governance things I talked about and the control of the data, the three other things that it brings, one is it creates a decentralized, immutable, which means it can't be written over, trustless public registry of transactions. So think about that. It's like a public data store of all the transactions that goes on. It means market data is no longer the purview of the exchanges or any of the other entities that control it. Market data is now going to be public. Now, it's not going to reveal personal information. So it's not going to say, oh, Asif did this trade with Darren, for example. All it'll say is this wallet did this trade with that wallet or this transaction with that wallet. And you can know, anybody can query the decentralized database and put together all the market data they want for free because nobody owns it. It's collective and therefore it's available. That's a very different place than where we are today. Secondly, it allows for bilateral real-time settlement of transactions. If I was to transact with Darren, for example, today, if I wanted to send money to somebody in China, one of you in China, I'd have to go through my bank, which have to go through another bank, which have to go to another entity. There's probably six or seven entities that it would cross before it got to the person I was trying to send the money to. And each of those entities in between, first of all, charge a fee. Secondly, there's risk in whether they fail or not. So it creates a lot of cost and complexity in the system. With blockchain, none of that happens. If I know the address I'm trying to send it to, a blockchain address, or even the alias of a blockchain address, I can send it more or less for the cost of sending an email. So that is a very different place than where we are today. And then the third is that we have programmable money. Now, we've had digital money for years, right? So if I go and look at my bank statement or go query my bank online, it'll tell me how much money I have. That's just a digital representation of the cash. It's not the actual cash, okay? We've had digital cash for years. But we haven't had programmable cash. And now you have programmable money. And what that means, for example, is it takes, again, a lot of intermediaries out of the middle of a transaction to let transactions settle bilaterally. So let's say Darren and I agree that we're going to bet on the Warriors game this afternoon or this evening. I've actually never met Darren in real life. My ability to collect from Darren should I win the bet is probably pretty low, therefore. But if we set up a smart contract, and we both had blockchain wallets, we could set it up that said, hey, if the Warriors win, then I win the bet. And if the Warriors lose, then Darren wins the bet. And here, we're gonna wager $10, let's say. And the smart contract basically would make sure it holds $10 in Darren's wallet and $10 in my wallet as collateral. And then as soon as the game is over and it knows who's won, it can query a source for that data. It'll settle the transaction. If the Warriors win, Darren's $10 comes to me. If the Warriors lose, my $10 go straight to Darren's wallet, and the whole thing settled bilaterally without any risk, right? And again, more or less at the cost of sending an email. Those are profound changes to what currently is our system of transaction flow. It means we no longer need intermediaries for all these transactions. And the financial transactions are rife with intermediaries because of the way that our infrastructure was built. Those intermediaries add cost, they add risk, and they add time, all of which go away by using things like blockchain. Okay. Now, at this point, some of you in China are saying, that doesn't apply to us. You guys in the West have this antiquated infrastructure. It's too bad for you. You're going to have to go fix it. We have more modern infrastructure. That's true. China does have more modern infrastructure for a lot of payments. You've skipped some of the things we had to do. However, your systems are still highly centralized with lots of intermediaries, even though it's more modern. You basically made our crappy system slightly less crappy, but it's still crappy because it's got a lot of these intermediaries in it. And so all these benefits that I talk about, control of the data, the network effects accruing to the users, not the network builder, the bilateral real-time settlement, the public database that's queryable, all of those things still apply even in places like China. So let's talk about some real use cases, right? And you'll have heard a lot about DeFi that in the press and all the growth in DeFi, et cetera. And that's true. There's been a tremendous amount of growth in DeFi. All of the DeFi work, though, that's been going on and that's in the press is basically taking traditional transactions, lending, saving, payments, et cetera. And it's bringing those services to people who are long crypto, who already have a lot of crypto. And that's entirely the wrong way around because there are very few people, relatively speaking, who have a lot of crypto. Most of the world, in fact, the vast majority of this world does not have any crypto. And the challenge really and the opportunity is to leverage crypto or blockchain as a development platform to restructure financial services without the risk, without the cost, back for the average user to be able to consume financial services at very, very low cost with full control. That is what I'm really talking about. And that is being done in many ways. So let's talk about a few. We already talked about the person-to-person payment, me trying to send money to somebody in China. Again, as long as I have a wallet on a blockchain and they have a wallet on the same blockchain and I know what their address is or they've given me an alias or something, I can simply tell the application to send the payment. The payment is sent. There's very little cost for doing that unless you're in Ethereum, but we'll skip that Ethereum will fix itself at some point. And it should be no more expensive than sending an email. This is profound, right? So think of the poor person who's working in the Philippines, sorry, the poor Filipino maid who's working in the Middle East or something. If she's sending money back to her family, it's probably costing her 20 to 30% by the time you think of all of the hops it takes and all of the intermediaries. That basically is ridiculous. It should be more or less for free, and it can be using crypto. Now, again, the skeptics are saying, hey, we have Venmo and we have Alipay and it can do all that. Yes, it can do some of that. Not at that cost structure, in a centralized way where it collects all the data, and it's not programmable. Okay, again, the fact that it could be programmable, the fact that it's decentralized, the fact that you have control of the data is a fundamentally better way of doing it than these centralized structures that we have. The second example is a merchant payment. Merchant payments are really no different than person-to-person payments. It's just that the thing on the other end is a merchant, and the merchant can generate a QR code. I can snap it with my phone. Again, I can get paid. Again, you in China are going to say, oh, we have that already. We've got QR codes. It's you in the US who don't have that stuff. Yes, that's partially correct. But again, it's the way it's being done in China and other places. All the data is centrally collected. It's a centralized system. There's no sharing of the economics. There is a better way to do it where the economics are shared and the data is private and the costs are much, much lower. And what you need to do that is a stablecoin. In other words, a crypto, which is backed one for one by fiat that people understand. It could be the US dollar, it could be the euro, it could be the yuan, it could be anything that the market actually appreciates and understands the stable value of. And we have built now in the United States, Figure has done this, the company I'm with right now, a stable coin that banks can actually use. So when I was at Coinbase, we created a stable coin called USDC. there's now, I think, something like $40 billion of USDC floating around, which is great. But the mistake we made is we let it go between any wallet anywhere, which means no banks will touch it, because banks have a fiduciary duty to know the customer or know the person that the funds are going to. That's the regulation around the world, so that we, you know, don't do terrorist financing and so on. And so we created a version of that coin called USDF, which basically only exists between bank certified accounts. So if you are at a bank and you're a customer of the bank, then you can send this. And again, it runs on a blockchain rails, therefore it's much lower cost. You control the data. You participate in the upside economics. It's much lower cost, much faster. So and allows the settlement of real-time transactions. You combine all of these things together around a stablecoin, and you could basically create an entire end-to-end banking platform, person-to-person payments, person-to-merchant payments, lending, etc. And you could create that at very, very low cost. So we have a product at Figure, which is basically Chime, Venmo, Affirm, and Square, all on blockchain on a mobile app. In the Chinese equivalent would be something like an Alipay merged with a WeChat, merged with a banking app, with a credit app, all together, all on blockchain. And we're able to basically bank just about anybody because the costs are so much lower. There's no such thing as the unbanked anymore because everyone can afford to be afford a bank account. And the merchants save literally billions of dollars of interchange from Visa and MasterCard because it runs on blockchain rails, not on the legacy Visa MasterCard rails. And the users have control of the data, and the users actually are able to participate in the upside of the economics. So that was banking. Let's talk about and payments. Let's talk about equities trading, or just trading in general. In the US, we suffer from basically 1970s era infrastructure, which is why we're on, you know, settlement of T plus 2 days. So when the trade happens, it's 2 days later that the transaction actually settles, which means for 2 days, funds are flowing around and certificates are flowing around and stuff. That creates a lot of risk in the system. So there's literally billions of dollars every minute at risk because it takes us so long to settle these transactions. Again, in China, you're probably sitting there saying, yeah, we're luckier. We have same day settlement. Yes, you do, but it's not instant. It's same day settlement over a course of a few hours. So it's slightly better than what we have, but it still has a lot of the same infrastructure problems. It's a lot of the same capital problems. It's a lot of the same risk problems, a lot of the same intermediaries that you're relying on, and therefore a lot of the same costs. None of that needs to happen. In the current system, brokers, settlement agents, depositories all provide credit to one another, all have balances outstanding, all have risk controls around that, all use capital to do that. It creates a lot of cost and a lot of risk in the system. And we don't need to have it that way because blockchain allows real-time bilateral settlement. Crypto trades 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and settles instantly. Billions of dollars settle this way every day. And so that is the future of how exchanges will work. We at Figure built an exchange on blockchain that can handle the volume of both NASDAQ plus the NYSE. And we showed it to the Depository Trust and Trading Corporation, which is the entity that ultimately controls how trading is done in the United States, showed it how it could work. And they could not be less interested. Why? Because they're the ones who have the most to gain from the current system working the way it does, because they are the intermediary of all intermediaries, right? And there's a lesson in here, which I'm going to come to. But we were able to take that exchange, and we were able to show it to participants in the marketplace. So banks and companies, investment banks and companies and so on. And we're now building a version of this for private companies, where private companies can basically manage their cap tables, funds can manage their funds on chain, and all the trading can happen in a 24/7 real-time bilateral risk-free settlement system. And that's what's happening there. So we have major private equity funds, we have major private companies, we have major investors all trading now on this exchange, and it's growing over time. It's happening today. Okay, so that's the trading use case. Let's talk about the third use case, which is loan origination. Lending is one of the biggest markets in the world. It's actually bigger, much bigger than equities. If I was to talk about lending in the United States, basically the first thing you have to know about that is most lending in the United States is not done by banks. It's done by specialty financial institutions that basically wholesale fund. So what they do is they borrow money from somebody else. They then lend consumers money, either for a house, unsecured, or secured, and then they combine those loans into a package and they sell that package of loans to investors to invest in. That's how the system works. So in the current world, if I was a lender, I would borrow, say, $100 million from a major bank. I would then go lend it in sort of $100,000 chunks to consumers for, say, you know, fixing up their home or whatever it is. Once I had lent out that $100 million, I would then go to the market and say, hey, I have $100 million worth of loans to sell. This is the credit score on average of those loans. This is the value to loan to value ratio for those loans. This is the geographic distribution for those loans. And by the way, here's the servicing history in terms of how often people are paying and how many of the loans are current. Based on all that, I'd get a bunch of bids from the market. I would pick the buyer that has the best bid. They would put some money aside in escrow so that I know that they're good for the amount of money that they're supposed to pay me. I put my loans in escrow so that the buyer knows that the loans are there and are ready to be delivered to them. Then they would hire an auditor, and the auditor would go look at my loans and make sure that what I represented as the loans is actually true. And if all that checks out, then that trade finally settles and I get the money from the buyer and I send the loans to the buyer. That process end to end is about 90 days. So 90 days is $100 million tied up. It's very expensive. It creates a lot of infrastructure risk. It creates a lot of cost. And none of that needs to happen if you use blockchain. So how do we do it now? When we originate a loan at Figure, when we get a credit score on somebody, we publish the credit score to the blockchain. When we get a valuation, we put the valuation on the blockchain. When we do servicing, we do servicing in real time, and all of that's published to the blockchain. So now when we have loans for sale, we don't go in and test anything to the market. We don't say we have a bunch of loans that look like this. We just say, here are the loans, and you can see it replaces trust with truth. You can see for yourself what the loan values are, what the servicing history is, what the credit scores were. And if you're interested in buying them, you can buy them. And the way we buy them is we put them up on the exchange as individual loans for sale, and buyers buy them. By the way, if you want to think about it, the loan actually is an NFT. It's a non-fungible token. And in this way, we now have billions of dollars of loans being originated, serviced, and sold this way in real time with, again, far lower cost because there's not capital tied up for 90 days, far less risk because there's no settlement risk on the transaction. And all of this, third-party auditors have come back and said, saved 120 basis points, 1.2% in the all-in cost structure. Now, that's 1.2% across trillions of dollars of lending in the United States. So this is a gigantic opportunity for the industry. So let me summate here. What I'm trying to get across is we're on the cusp of Internet 3. Internet 3 is going to be a much more fundamental change than the Internet 1 and 2 changes that came before us, which are basically just self-service and mobile. Internet 3 is going to be much more fundamental because it's blockchain-based and it's going to rewrite how financial services works because it doesn't need intermediaries and gives control back to the user for those transactions, and it allows real-time settlement. And so the user benefits, and it's lower cost, and it's lower capital, and therefore you can basically apply financial services for the same cost as it is to send an email. It's happening now. It's not going to be in the future. We're not talking 10 years from now. It's happening today. And it's going to be happening around the world, not just the United States, including China. So I'm going to stop there. I know we have a few minutes for questions, so I'm happy to take some questions to the extent we have any time. And again, I thank you for inviting me to this forum.
Wow, such a thought-provoking remarks and around decentralized finance. I'm especially intrigued by the smart contracts between you and me, you know, on betting on the Warrior Games, but looks like our audience are taking your remarks much more serious than I am. And looking at all these questions that I've seen, you'll be surprised. These are some hard questions. A lot of them are surrounded around around topics about money laundering and regulations. So if I may paraphrase, how will anti-money laundering and regulations play a role in the DeFi future? And is there a way to prevent money laundering on blockchain?
So the short answer is no, there's no way to prevent money laundering on blockchain, but blockchain is actually much less good for money laundering than the traditional methods are, because blockchain is not, while it may be not personally identifiable, it's still traceable. So when we were at Coinbase, and if you looked at some of the stories that came out just now about the hackers who were holding hostage a bunch of corporations in the United States, they tracked down the cryptocurrencies that were used as payments, because you can follow across the network how the payments ran, and you can block the addresses from being able to transact in the network. And that can be done. In fact, you know, the currency that's used the most for crime, because it's the least traceable, most convertible, is cash. If cash were invented today, it would be illegal by the way that people have defined currencies. If cash was invented today, it'd be illegal. So it's not, there's no such thing as a crime-free payment mechanism. There isn't. But crypto, while it gives all these benefits I talked about, it is still traceable to some extent, and it is more traceable than cash.
Got it. Well, thank you so much, Asif. It is very pleasure for us to having you today. And I believe every one of us, including all of our hundreds of our audience from both China and United States who are tuning in tonight, got a lot of insights from you about how we should expect the Internet 3, the way you describe it, the Internet 3 will come, that will reshape our financial services. So I will wrap our keynote tonight. And thank you so much, Asif. And really pleasure to having you tonight.
Thank you for inviting me. Take care. Good luck, everybody. Bye-bye.
Thank you.